A prodigal of our rich divinity, herself and all she was, she had lent to men, hoping her greater being to implant that heaven might native grow on mortal soil. Savitri comes in her full richness, and she offers that full richness to the soul of the earth. She offers that full richness that heaven might grow native in this mortality. Savitri has come to the mortal world. She has taken the mortal birth. She came to fulfill an obligation. She came to fulfill an obligation in the abysmal darkness of the night. She has identified herself with a mortal soul. She has identified herself with the soul of the earth. She has identified herself with the soul of mortality. Without that identification, things would not move. Things would not get accomplished. Things would not happen. The omniscient goddess, she came here, but she had to go back, because unless she takes the mortal birth, she cannot really identify herself with the mortal creation, with the lot of mortality. Savitri comes here assuming, accepting that mortal birth. But though she has accepted the mortal birth, she does not lose her contact with the divine soul that she is, with her divinity. Though she has accepted this mortal birth, yet she retains contact with her vaster nature, Brahat Prakriti, Para Prakriti. She is constantly in contact with her vaster nature, Brahat Prakriti. The divine becomes one with the world, but never loses his divinity. That divinity is not a contingent divinity, circumstantial divinity, conditioned by factors of creations here. It is not a fortuitous divinity. Savitri does not need a grain of grief for her joy to endure. It is the mortal who needs a grain of grief for him to enjoy life and to endure. Savitri does not need a grain of grief for her joy to endure. In her identification with the mortal soul, Savitri wears one soul with all the other souls. That oneness is her key to the flaming gates of ecstasy. She is in possession of it. Savitri is in possession of the key to the flaming gates of ecstasy, the key of oneness with all the souls. Savitri is given passion flower of love, of that oneness, given the flower of love, of oneness, oneness with all. She has made a sacrifice for that. She has sacrificed her glory, her greatness, her majesty. The immortal has accepted the mortal birth. But that glorious sacrifice of her love doesn't seem to achieve anything. Nothing really, anything radical. The sacrifice seems to be all in vain. She has given abundant gifts to man, countless gifts of love, joy, sweetness, power, knowledge. She has given countless gifts to man of light. She, the spendthrift, did not care anything. She didn't care anything in the least how these gifts are received by man. She did not care about that. She was lavish in giving these gifts. She gave these gifts, these boons, to all. The cherished hope was, in giving these boons, the cherished hope was, heaven might native grow on the earth's soil. That was the expectation. That was the supposition. The supposition was the prodigal weight of apricots on the branch would make it bend low. But it was a bad habit and nothing seemed to matter. The apricot remained hung in the midair. It was a bad habit and nothing seemed to matter. It is hard to persuade earth nature to change. Earth nature cannot be changed easily. It cannot give up its past habits. The habits don't die easily. Past habits and new and greater truths, it does not accept. Past habits does not accept new and greater truths. Indeed, habits are stiff and they don't die even in the death of their possessor. The gifts are repelled. Somebody is offering you a gift, you don't accept it. Rather, you push it away from you. The gifts are repelled. Repelled in defiance. Always the Savior hands of grace are pushed away. Not only the gifts are repelled, the hands of the bringer of the gifts are pushed away. What is offered to him, to this bringer of gifts, are death and pain. The sons of God who come here to save the world, receive from the world only hostilities. Savitri too is meeting that kind of a fate. She came here with abundant gifts. She lavished them on the mortal soul. She brought a key of oneness. She brought love. But on her is inflicted the law of suffering and death. Savitri has to bear it. She has to carry the yoke of fate. She has to meet death. She has to confront the antagonist who is standing across her work, across the path of her work. Savitri is meeting that fate. In fact, actually, she has come to confront death in order to eliminate death. Death that cannot be, death who cannot be conquered by anyone else except the incarnate divine power herself. Savitri is here to meet death. In order to conquer death, it is death, the embodied nothingness, the thick shadow assuming the figure of death. It is he who must be removed from the scene. Savitri has come for that. Savitri has to bear all the sufferings in order to meet this figure of death, this embodiment of death, this person, this individual, this death. In order to remove him, she must take the mortal birth, accept the lot of mortality, the difficulties of mortality, the pain and suffering of mortality, and conquered death. She is here for that. Savitri has to bear the law of pain and suffering and death.